This is part two of the Conlang video, where we'll be talking mostly about how it applies to other languages in the narrative. So this is actually the more interesting part. So we are going to be discussing about how a Conlang applies to other languages used in the narrative, that is languages that is not spoken by the main character or the main cast on a regular basis, and not the language where most of the conversation takes place in. So we're talking about that kind of language. An example would be, say, Elvish in Lord of the Rings. And the issue we're discussing is whether we need a Conlang for this kind of language. And we're specifically talking about the fantasy genre. You could avoid the Conlang problem if you choose to not have any excerpts in your Conlang. You'd miss the chance to world build the culture the way you would if you were using a Conlang, but there are ways around that. You could sidestep the issue by indicating whether your viewpoint character understood what's being said or not, or you could translate it into English or whatever language you're writing in, or you could just explain the mood or tone. This is also one way to avoid, you know, creating a complete Conlang. You could still have names, place names, exclamations in your Conlang in this scenario. So it could also be a strategy to avoid dealing with grammar. That is especially true if you've written yourself into a corner with about 15 cases and 4 grammatical genders. That way you get to create a language. You know firsthand how difficult it is to learn as a second language, but you don't have to write a sentence and check it 10 times before putting it in a book. Another possible avoidance strategy would be to use another pre-existing language in place of your Conlang. This is not a very good strategy. You can avoid creating a Conlang, but I wouldn't recommend it. For one, there is a possibility of introducing unfortunate implications, especially if you stray into stereotypes attached to your language, to the language you're choosing. Another potential issue is if you make a mistake, there will be thousands of native speakers who will realize where you went wrong. This is especially true if you're just learning this particular language just to put it in your book. Another issue is you could end up using words from an online translator, which could have meanings that were different from the one you intended. So in short, keep clear of this strategy. Do not use it. If you plan to create a Conlang, you can do so. But unless you have a lot of experience with this, or unless you're very familiar with languages in general, I would recommend keeping relatively close to what you know, but not too close to keep the, you know, the fantasy element there. The Indo-European constructed language is a trope for a reason. This is especially important if you plan to have any conversation in your Conlang. But if you decide to go with a complicated Conlang anyway, it might take you a little while to reach the level of fluency you need to write a conversation in it. Even if it's relatively close to your mother tongue, you'd have a bit of a learning curve with regards to vocabulary. My personal favorite strategy with regards to this is to write songs and poems using the language, world build a little, try to figure out how different dialects work. So that may not work for you, but you need to figure out the strategy that works best for your story. In conclusion, there is no universal best approach for this. It depends on what you want to do, how much effort you need to put into it, and frankly, what your particular writing project needs. So that's it for this video. And see you next time.